Some people are participating today via Zoom, so a special welcome to them. Please note that the service is being recorded and will be uploaded later this week to YouTube. Please turn and greet your neighbors with a hello or a wave.
Thank you.
recording because Parker called in sick, and we hope Parker's feeling better at home. And, very nice that Paul could fill in for us. And also, I guess I should introduce our guest singer, Michael Orlinsky, is that right, Orlinsky? Who will be singing the anthem for us. So we have some special musicians as a change, for a change. So please stand as you are capable or comfortable and join me in the call to worship found in your bulletin. If you would please read the bold. From the rising of the sun till its setting in the west, God's holy name be praised. On the lips of children, by babies at the breast, God's holy name be praised. In the visions of the old and the dreaming of the young, God's holy name be praised. In the banquet hall of heaven and the forgotten corners of our hearts, God's holy name be praised. Let all that has life and breath praise the Lord. Amen. We praise the Lord. Now, if you would join me in singing hymn number 15, All Creatures of Our God and King, we're going to sing verses 1 through 3 and verse 6, which is down below. Please join me in the prayer out your cares and concerns. Breathe out your doubts and despairs. Breathe out your fears and frustrations. Breathe out your tensions and turmoil. Breathe out your haste and hurry. Breathe out your work and worry. We sit quietly before the one who gives life and love to all creation. We sit in awe of the one who formed us in our mother's wombs. We sit at peace, surrounded by the one who fills every fiber of our being. Now, breathe in the breath of God. Breathe in the love of God. Breathe in the life of God. Breathe in the peace of God. Breathe in the faithfulness of God. Breathe in the breath of God. You are not alone in your struggles or your worries, because God is as close as your very breath. Breathe in deeply the breath of God.
I'm going to reverse the order of the readings in your bulletin today. So our first reading is going to be the Psalm, Psalm 85, verses 1 through 13. And I'd like to read this responsibly. So if you would all read the indented lines, I will read the first lines. Lord, you were favorable to your land.
You restored
You forgave the iniquity of your people.
You pardoned all their sins.
You withdrew all your wrath.
You turned from your hot anger.
Restore us again, O God, of our salvation.
And put away your indignation towards us.
Will you be angry with us forever?
Will you prolong your anger to all generations?
Will you not revive us again?
So that your people may rejoice in you.
Show us your steadfast love, O Lord.
And grant us your salvation.
Let me hear what God, the Lord, will speak.
For he will speak peace to his people, to his faithful, to those who turn to him in their hearts.
Surely God's salvation is at hand for those who fear God.
Let his glory be known among them.
Steadfast love and faithfulness will meet.
Righteousness will meet against each other.
Faithfulness will spring up from the ground.
And righteousness will look down from the sky.
The Lord will give what is good.
And the Lord will give you what is good.
Righteousness will go before God.
And will make his path for his steps.
Thank you.
from Luke 11, 1 through 13. He was praying in a certain place, and after he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, "Lord, teach us to pray as John taught his disciples." So he said to them, "When you pray, say, Father, may your name be revered as holy. May your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread. And forgive us our sins. For we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us. And do not bring us to the time of trial." And he said to them, "Suppose one of you has a friend and you go to him at midnight and say to him, 'Friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread, for a friend of mine has arrived and I have nothing to set before him.' And he answers from within, 'Do not bother me. The door has already been locked and my children are with me in bed. I can't get up and give you anything.' I tell you, even though he will not get up and give you anything out of friendship, at least because of his persistence, he will get up and give him whatever he needs. So I say to you, ask, and it will be given to you. Search, and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened for you. For everyone who asks, receives. And everyone who searches, finds. And for everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. Is there anyone among you who, if your child asked for a fish, would give a snake instead of a fish? Or if the child asked for an egg, would give a scorpion? If you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him?" For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God within us, thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Mr. Orlinsky, you had preached a far finer sermon than this, and with Ralph Vaughn Williams than I would be able to preach coming after you. My name is Christopher Ocker. I'm the dean at San Francisco Theological Seminary and a professor of the history of Christianity there. I'm a member of the doctoral faculty of Graduate Theological Union. Thank you very much for welcoming me to your pulpit today. Linda, I count as a friend, also a student, and a colleague. She directs our field education program at the seminary. So it's a special pleasure to be here. The Gospel of Luke is an odd duck of a gospel. It shares many stories with the Gospel of Matthew, but it puts many of them in very different contexts. And the stories are clearly distinct versions. In Matthew, the Lord's Prayer appears in its familiar form, the way we always pray it, tucked into the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount is a long discourse that offers a virtual handbook of Jesus' basic and most humane teachings. In both versions, Matthew and Luke, all scholars agree, there's nothing about the prayer that is distinctly Christian. It's a rather typical Jewish prayer. It's hard to imagine a rabbi who would have trouble praying it. For good reason, medieval and Reformation Christians, churches, both Protestants and Catholics, included Matthew's version of the Beatitudes, which begin the Sermon on the Mount, and the Lord's Prayer, which also appears in the Sermon on the Mount, in their catechisms, books that were used to teach children basic literacy and doctrine. It's hard not to think of Matthew's version of the Lord's Prayer as standard, fulsome, correct. Today the lectionary asks us to consider Luke. His version of the familiar prayer is so different. It comes up in an almost random story in the sermon, not in the Sermon on the Mount. The text says, he was praying in a certain place. Where? Why? When? And after he had finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray as John taught his disciples. John? Why John? This is a reference to an intriguing sub-theme in the Gospels and in the book of Acts, where we get tiny suggestions of competition between the followers of John the Baptist and the followers of Jesus. But it's hard to know what the point of this reference really is. Is it to say that both teachers are good, both Jesus and John are good? Is it to say that, oh, this is what a better version, a Jesus version of the prayer looks like? We have no idea. And we read on, the passage gets stranger still. When you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, for we ourselves forgive everyone indebted to us, and do not bring us to the time of trial. And that's supposed to be the Lord's Prayer? Why the missing parts? Our Father, who art in heaven, where is your will be done? Where is deliver us from evil? Does Luke give us a more original or truer version of the Lord's Prayer? Is it truncated, shortened? Why would one writer, Matthew, expand it or another shorten it? There are a myriad historical questions that scholars have spent a great deal of time trying to answer, but the truth of the matter is, we don't really know. All we know is we have this version. And the lectionary today is asking us to consider the one in Luke. Luke contextualizes the story in his own way. Not in the Sermon on the Mount, not in a kind of summary of basic devotional teachings. But as an example, Luke adds to this short version an example, a little vignette that only Luke tells, no other gospel. The text continues. And he said to them, suppose one of you has a friend, and you go to the friend at midnight and say to the friend, friend, lend me 3 loaves of bread, for a friend of mine has arrived, and I have nothing to set before him. And the friend answers from within the house, do not bother me, the door has already been locked, and my children are with me in bed. I cannot get up to give you anything. I tell you, Jesus says, even though he will not get up and give him anything, because he is a friend, because of his persistence, he will get up and give him whatever he needs. Okay, so that's a little vignette that says that prayer is something like neighborly love and generosity. Then comes a segment of text, another segment of text similar to one in Matthew, but put in a different place. Luke continues. So I say to you, ask and it will be given to you. Search and you will find. Knock, and the door will be opened for you. For everyone who asks receives, and everyone who searches finds. And for everyone who knocks, the door will be opened. Is there anyone among you who, if your child asks for a fish, will give a snake instead of a fish?
No.
Or if the child asks for an egg, if you then, who are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? So the entire business of the Lord's Prayer in the Gospel of Luke ends with this somewhat confusing encouragement to pray. Knock, and the door will be opened for you. But the fine print says, the Heavenly Parent will give the Holy Spirit to those who ask, which is a kind of surprising answer if we are asking for a fish or an egg. What on earth is today's gospel trying to teach us about prayer? I think it may be an answer to a question. The question, why pray? I feel the force of the examples in our reading very acutely today. This week, about a third of our home was severely damaged by an accidental fire. No one was hurt. The fire was quickly put out. We are insured. So much worse could have happened. So much worse happens in the world every day. But my wife and I did enter a time of trial. As this spectacle unfolded in our neighborhood, so many people offered us food and shelter long before we could ask for anything. We were overwhelmed by the kindness of those we thought were mere acquaintances and strangers, but who believed in their hearts that neighbors need to be friends. I wonder if, while we are asking for fish and eggs, we might be getting the Holy Spirit. You know, in antiquity, at the time when the Gospels were written, the standard medicine of the day said that spirit is a kind of vaporous substance in the body, a kind of misty something in your body, a kind of bridge between the body and the soul, produced by the heart, partly fortified by spirit drawn from the air in the lungs and refined by the brain. They thought it was mixed with blood and pumped around your body to energize muscles, forming a physical link between the action of willpower in the soul and the body. Spirit, in that ancient medicine, was the source of human mobility. The words, as you probably know, the words ruach in Hebrew, huma in Greek, and spiritus in Latin, all meant spirit, and wind, moving air. This concept of spirit seems to play a very important role course, the ancient science of spirit is medically incorrect. Yet the human heart, in its spiritual sense, is indeed a miraculous organ, and it's still a center point of Holy Spirit. Each and every one of us can remember times of trial. They are a part of life. They can feel piercing and dangerously corrosive. They can drive us into moments of extreme emotional isolation. If we are lucky, we can see through the darkness and marvel at the kindness of strangers and friends. But that can be very hard to do when it feels like the walls of comfortable expectation are burning down around you. We should look for Holy Spirit pouring out of human hearts. Is there anyone among us who, if a child asks for a fish, will give a snake? If a child asks for an egg, will give a scorpion? If a neighbor meets tragedy, will close the drapes and look away? Ask, knock, you will receive. In words that have strangely come to me in times of distress in my life, the Rolling Stones said, you don't always get what you want, but if you try, you just might find you get what you need. Oh yeah. And you might detect Holy Spirit. So why pray? A sound theology of prayer says, turn to God for everything. Really, anything at all. It is right to do this. But we are praying to God, the name we give to the living being of goodness and truth in its ultimate dimensions. What God promises to give back to us is Holy Spirit. The Gospel of Luke says, this is the teaching of Jesus. The Spirit we discover in the faces of family, friends, neighbors, and strangers when we confront a time of need. When we pray, may we have the courage to receive. Would you please sing with our company guest, hymn 630, Paris, Lord Jesus. Are filled with your blessings, O God. The air we breathe, the food we eat, the homes we live in, the health that permits us to be here, the people we love who also love us. Grant that we may never live insensitively, but may praise and worship you endlessly for your goodness. Concerns of our hearts, great and small, knowing that your power and your love is inexhaustible, without end. No request is too small or too great for you. Hear, O God, the names of those we wish to lift before you today. Give you thanks for the things you have done for us, O Lord. We lift these names and those who rest in our hearts. Dear God, come to the side of those in need. Comfort them, heal them, help them know that you are God and that your will prevail in this world. And hear us as we pray together.
Now, let us return to God the offerings of our life and the gifts of the earth. If you'd like to give a gift today, the offering plates will be passed. And we also want to remember that many of you are giving gifts in them by the snail mail, by dropping them in the office, by sending them electronically, and we want to include those gifts. Would the ushers please come forward?
Thank you.
31. Made by Kathy and Joanne for Kathy's wedding. And so I'm gonna see if Kathy will let us keep these for when we don't have flowers, because it's so special to have things that she made when she's not able to be here with us for the reasons that she can tell you about. Yes. And on the same note, though, if you would like to bring flowers of the other sort, like the kind that God made, we have our flower board over here, and we'd love you to sign up for a particular Sunday that you would like to honor God and help us worship with some of God's flowers. So that's what I want. And then I was going to mention something about... Oh, yes, you will mention something about music camp.
All right, I'm really excited. Since I don't have a full year with children to look forward to, I can enjoy 1 week. Yes. Sorry, I just retired from teaching, in case you were wondering what I'm talking about. So I actually have energy and excitement this year to lead with Parker Grant. He's going to do the music part. I'm going to be the cheerleader and organizer of everything else. And I'm getting crafts ready. We're going to be making musical instruments. So if this week you happen to finish a roll of paper towels, thank you, Marty, for my first two contributions. If you finish a roll of paper towels and you remember, please bring some paper towel rolls next Sunday. We'll be using those to make rain sticks. I also want to make bracelets with jingle bells, and I was gonna buy some, and I'm like, wait a minute, let me check my craft box, and sure enough, random things in my own craft box, and I thought, I bet other people have random craft boxes with jingle bells as well. So if you know you have random jingle bell things, let me know, because I can use those. We also have flyers that Amanda Dill made for us with a QR code. She is so high tech. So we have a QR code. If you know neighbors, little kids, go for it. Ask them. It's going to be really, really fun. fun. We'll be here 9 to noon next week, August 1st, 2nd, 3rd, 4th, and 5th, 9 to noon. And if they can make it on Sunday, it would be lovely. We'll be doing a performance. That's about it. Thanks.
Do you need snacks, or have you got snacks organized?
Snacks in there.
Thank you.
Okay, I think that's it, unless somebody else has another ministry opportunity. Well, thank you.